the entire situation is right in front of us, so it's a very exciting time. No matter how we may feel on any given day, it's still very appropriate to make a huge push whenever we can. So I've taken a couple days off from taping, but it's very eventful right now. I went to a shopping mall yesterday, first time I've been to one of those in a long, long, long time. And my gosh, I came home and I lay down and all this imagery started flooding my mind. I said, where is this coming from? It's horrible. I said, this is not coming from me. I picked up all the etheric, the subtle thought forms that were in this mall. And it was terrible, really terrible. All these demonic, monstrous, dragon-like, reptilian-like entities and all their distortions and all their energy and all the demands and all this stuff was just like swirling like a phantasmagoria. Just looking at like a movie, I'd say, where in the world did this come from? It came from the mall. The malls are cesspools that of decay, of energy body decay, not just physical, etheric, emotional, mental, causal, all the... They're places that generate this fleshy attraction focused on the superficial, the flesh, and the subtle etheric forms feed off of that. That's really their energy, where they get their food. Just like in this world, there's plenty of microorganisms that feed off of decay, right? When fruit falls, when anything starts rotting and decaying, there's all sorts of stuff that feed off of decay. And so these etheric entities, they feed off decay of humans, of the flesh, fleshy decay, and they lead us into this flesh pots where everything just kind of rots and decays. Throughout history, you've seen that happening. And the malls are centers for that. My gosh, the people there and the attitudes is so flesh-oriented, it's unbelievable. So I had to clean that out of my system. It was horrible, really horrible, which is why I stay away from shopping centers, shopping malls, you know, at all costs. I had to go in there to help someone out. But a very nasty, terrible place, my gosh, on subtle levels. It's like the whole place is like encased with these fungus that is growing off of the energy in those places, and they're encouraging all these cycles of physical flesh-based focus and attraction and glamour and all of that that goes along with that. So, and I thought myself, you know, I feel like burned out because these are parasites. The etheric parasites are simply, there's a tree nearby, big pine tree, and used to be very healthy and radiant tree, and now it's dead, it's brown, it's why boar beetles got into it, parasites got into the tree, and they literally suck the life out of the tree. Same thing here in this world, that these etheric entities, parasites, get into you, your energy system, and they suck it dry and leave you like a burned out hull, which is what happened to me. So I'm speaking from experience. And I was thinking, well, what can I do about it? And I realized, well, I can instantly, you know, have this body become perfectly whole and well. I said, okay, and then what? And then suddenly I got this reaction from the world of saying, well, that's artificial. It's fake. It's artificial. And so this started this whole chain of consideration this morning. What is holding us back from escaping this viper pit that we're in? This snake pit, really. You know, the people, young people, creative people who draw and do animation, all this stuff, they always have these like serpents, you know, and dragons and serpents and fiery, you know, entities with all. Where do they get this, you think? You know, how can they dream up all this stuff of reptilian motives and monsters and dragons and all these things? And is because there's literally, that's what etherically they're seeing, that it's in their mind's eye. When you can tune into that, like I did last night, I saw all of it. They're seeing that, so they're busy depicting what it is that they're seeing. Actually, those entities, that those energy forms exist as energy forms and are functioning by sucking the energy out of humans. They use humans as a just like those boar beetles go into the tree and destroy the tree. These etheric energy forms are boring into our energy systems and sucking us dry and destroying us. So here we are, burned out. We're burned out. And what do we do? Again, I say you can instantly be whole and fresh and as if none of that ever happened. Now, these etheric entities, they scream foul. You know, they pull a red flag up and say, foul, or a yellow card. Here's a yellow card. You're out of the game. I want to kick you out of the game. They say, why? I say, why? And they say, because it's fake. It's fake. It's fakery. It's artificial. It's not real. I said, aha, I pull a red flag out on you, and I give you the yellow card, and you're out of the game. Okay, one of us is mistaken. And this is very crucial now, because going forward, you need to decide to snap out of it and get that fresh, vibrant wholeness, holiness. That is your inheritance, your right. And you're being deprived. You deprive yourself of it. You don't do this because you think it's fake, artificial, not real. So let us look at that. What is real and what is fake? All important going forward. We believe that what is derived from process is real. But the fact is, what is process is fake. It's hypothetical. In reality, there's no such thing as process. No such thing, because everything that is created is instantly what it is. There's only what is. There's no such thing as what is becoming or not yet fully what it is. No such thing like that at all. And intuitively, you know that is true. So everything is instantly, inherently, spontaneously, without any other possibility, fully what it is. No process involved. Creativity is direct and instantaneous with no process. It is process that is fake, that is artificial, that is hypothetical. It is saying that everything is not yet in its final configuration or form. It's not yet whole, that we're assembling parts. That is hypothetical. That is false. That is artificial. Existence is artificial. It's fake. It's not real. And reality is true, is real. Okay? And so we have it upside down and backwards here in this world, is what's going on. Our definition of what's artificial is completely opposite of the truth. That which cannot be harmed in any way is the true, and that which can be harmed is the artificial. So when we take on the holiness, which cannot be harmed, which is fresh, continually fresh, the parasites scream that that's artificial. They say, this is fake, this isn't real, we can't bore into it, you see. So they say it must be artificial. See, in this world, we assume that whatever is vulnerable to decay is real. And the stuff that's not, we say it's artificial, even though everything in existence is vulnerable to decay. But if we see something that is somehow can't be decayed, can't have microorganisms devour it, we call that artificial. Because the entire purpose of existence is to establish the power of destruction, of loss, of negation. And all this decay is how we're working on developing that. All of existence is this vastly, endlessly complex contraption of process, like a vast machine. And this vast machine is working on all these different mechanisms of destruction and decay. And of course, part of the machine is working on mechanisms of construction, because it's necessary to construct energy forms in order then to work on how to destroy them and decay them and destroy them. That's why I say it's a dance of constructivity and destructivity. And it's super, all these mechanisms, everywhere you look, there's endlessly complex mechanisms. Okay, but all of this is artificial. It's all designed to try and develop a power of negation over reality. That's all that it is. And so all of this vast contraption that we call existence, this machine with so many moving parts, as it were, energy forms, everything feeding off of everything else, vast phantasmagoria, that's all fake. Why? Because it ends up with absolutely nothing. The product, the end product of existence, is nothing, absolutely nothing at all. It never comes up with any power of negation. Never. So it's fake. It's completely fake. It's a fake. Existence is a fake. Okay. But that which cannot decay, that which doesn't need any process to be what it is, that is real. So when you take on holiness in this world, you're taking on reality. You're shining the real into the fake, the artificial. But those existence will scream that you're a fake, that you're artificial, because you cannot be part of the sacrificial contraption of existence. Sacrifice doesn't work. So there is this disagreement. There will be this profound disagreement. And of course, I don't want to give rise to that sort of thing, but there's no choice. You either are part of the sacrificial system, which the sum total of all of this contraptions working is nothing. It doesn't come up with anything. That's the product. It is simply not even nothing. There is no product. There is no product at all. It fails completely. And so that, you know, is not the real. It's the fake. It's the artificial. It's the unreal. It's that which is hypothetical. Completely artificial. Full of artifice. Meaning clever tricks. Artificial comes from artifice, which means to very cleverly arrange things in a deceptive way. That's what existence does. Existence is a journey. I hear all these people saying that it's the journey that's the important, not the destination. Well, what else can existence say? That's the mantra, that's the motto of existence. It's not the goal, it's the journey. That's the motto of existence, because what did I say? It's the journey, not the destination. Yeah. Because there is no goal, there is no destination, it's never reached. The existence is futile. There is no power of negation to be developed. So, of course, all existence can do is say, hey, enjoy the journey, because you're never going to reach the goal, the product, never. And of course, the journey is not enjoyable, because you're being preyed on constantly. These etheric parasites are not a joke. We are being preyed upon by these etheric energy forms. In times gone by, it was talked about how there are various saints in the world that would drive off the dragons. I think Saint Patrick in Ireland drove out the snakes. What he's talking about is the subtle etheric energy forms that parasitically prey upon the human energy form. And the idea is that we're trying to keep the world free of these parasitic energy forms. But the problem is that in today's world, the whole world is rotting into this decadent, degraded fleshy condition, which invites these parasites, etheric parasites, to feast upon us. It's like anything in nature, when it gets into a certain form, poof, parasites jump on it. You know, if it gets weakened, you see plants. If they get weakened somehow, suddenly you see they're covered by white flies or scale, or, you know, aphids or fungus rot. All this rot comes in if they get out of balance. And these parasites, they want you to get out of balance. That's their whole thing. So they push that upon us subtly. They keep pushing bad lifestyles upon us, bad choices that serve their purpose. So we get out of balance. We're all out of whack in this world now, completely out of whack. And we're inviting ourselves to be preyed upon, very much so. And then there are those who prey upon these etheric parasites too, and we're inviting them in. There's a whole chain reaction. You know, you have dog poop in your backyard. If you don't keep the fences up, dog wanders in your backyard. Dog poop, what comes in? The maggots and the flies, you know, they come in. Then they get into your food, you know. It's a whole chain of decay. Existence, actually, the purpose again is decay, destruction. That is the real purpose. So, you know, we keep hearing these so-called spiritual teachings of you need to live in harmony with nature. That is not the correct teaching. You need to free yourself from nature, from process, because you inherently, inevitably get out of balance and go into decay. All civilizations, look at history, every single civilization has gotten out of balance and decayed, and this civilization here has gotten out of balance and is now in massive decay. This present civilization, world civilization we have, if you looked at, if the world was like a plant, you would see the plant is absolutely covered with all these parasitic insects that are sucking all the juice out of it. And the plant is extremely wilted and it's withering. And you can tell it's going to die. And, you know, of course, we're looking for pesticides, you know, some way to get this plant back. But it's too far gone, because literally the laws of the land have been changed to protect these etheric parasites and those who are infected with these parasites and those who are infecting the rest of us. By getting us out of balance, by having us make bad choices, get us out of balance, and our energy bodies are all out of balance, and then we get easily preyed upon, and the energy sucked out of us, and we ourselves fall down into, you know, all sorts of bad habits, drug addictions, self-destructive behavior, all the stuff. And these entities love to get us into drama, into terror, fear, hostility, fighting, conflict, hatred, all these things. They feast on that. Those are energies, vibrations that they absolutely feast upon. We understand in nature how everything is a conversion of energy. And it's not just on this physical level, it's on the subtle levels too. These subtler levels convert the energy of this physical level for their own purposes. Okay, so, and so it's this whole cycle. Existence is just all the cycles of conversion of energy into constantly converting, trying to transmute energy into reality. Energy is artificial. I know there's so many people talk about energy. It's artificial. It's fake. It's not real. There's no energy in reality. There's no need for energy, because energy is a process. Okay, it's always a conversion. There's always a movement. In reality, everything instantly is what it is, manifested as it is. There's no process at all in existence, no energy at all. So it's energy that's fake. So any teaching that's energy-based, you are just being set up to be preyed upon, to have what you are be converted into, broken down and converted. Excuse me. What you need is to put on the cloak of divinity, the unconditional love, which cannot be preyed upon, which cannot be converted, which cannot be broken down. And of course, then existence screams, "Ah, you're a fake! You're a deceiver! You're a liar! You're a hypocrite!" You know, you just the existence rejects that because it can't break it down. So it can't convert it into something else, break it down. This constant process of breaking down existence—that's all it's doing. And no matter how high of a balance and mindset you want, you make in energy, it still gets broken down. Everything, there's a weak energy is inherently vulnerable to that, because that's its purpose, is to be broken down, broken down, broken down. And then, of course, it arises again and builds up, and then it's broken down, broken down. But the goal is to develop this power of negation. And if that was possible, then all the constructivity would cease like that. But cease, because there's no more purpose for it. The purpose is entirely negative of existence. It's to develop this power of negation over reality so that we can intimidate and force the Prime Creator, threaten the Prime Creator with destruction of reality, so the Prime Creator then changes reality into the way that we want it, so that we can be Prime Creators, and the Prime Creator is now just an effect of us, and we can make all the rules the way we want to make them. If we were able to get that power of negation, all constructivity in existence would disappear. We'd drop it. So it's, constructivity is merely it's merely a device we're using so that we can work on destructivity. We couldn't work on developing destructivity if we didn't first have these energy forms that we define as life, or certain energy forms that can be then broken down. See, everything in existence, right? We build it up and then we break it down. You build a fruit up. I have tomatoes. The tomatoes fall. I let them just fall and watch what happens. And they just, of course, they wither, they shrink up. All these little insects that get into them, all this mold, this fungus, you know, breaks them down. Before you know it, poof, gone, disappeared. Everything in existence is like that. Gets broken down. Some different rates of breaking down. All of energy, the dynamics break down. This and this world, of course, is a focus of this plan to develop the power of negation. Because if you look at like Mars, I was looking at pictures of Mars. There's you know, very very not as much breaking down activity. It's slower. It's much slower. Look at the Moon. You look at Mars. You see Mars is just rock, dirt, rocks, some hills. You see the hills have been eroded over time, slow erosion. Here on this planet, everything, the vegetation, okay, all the vegetation, the corporal, the flesh of everything, all the fleshy activity, the vegetation activity, the micro activity on all these different levels, everything is being converted, ceaselessly being converted, broken down, built up, broken down, built up, broken down, built up, broken down. All these cycles searching for the ultimate breakdown. That's what existence is. And so, and it never will ever succeed, so it's fake. It's not real. It's imaginary. We made it up. It's a hypothetical. It's divinity that's real. But yet in this world, divinity is seen as fake. If you are that which cannot be broken down, unconditional love, you will be seen as you're fake, you're artificial. That you're somehow using some kind of artifice to deceive everyone. Because here we know everything has to be broken down. No such thing as what can't be broken down. If we take existence to be real, which it's not. So anything that cannot be broken down, we'll say that this must be a trick, an artifice. It's artificial. It's deceptive. It's the devil. It's deceit. If it cannot be broken down, that is the problem. So just to be for people to even listen to you in this world, I found you have to allow your energy bodies to be everything to be subject to be broken down. You have to accept an energy body system, an energy system. Otherwise, the people just say they won't listen to you. They say you're fake. You can't be real. You're not real. Because again, in here, what is deemed real is that which can be broken down. So I said, okay, if you think that which can be broken down is real, I'll just allow my whole system to be totally broken down, and then you'll think I must be really real. But no, because then they say, well, you don't have any vitality. We like vitality too. Can't win. The more you try to teach the truth here, the more people want you to demonstrate that you're vulnerable to being broken down, because they get nervous, because you're talking about what is real. To them, you're talking about what is artificial. See, they think that all this talk is about what's hypothetical. They got it backwards. It's existence that's the hypothetical. It's all this that's hypothetical. But the more you want to talk about reality, the more evidence they want from you that you're vulnerable, because that makes them feel comfortable. See, existence is comfortable with vulnerability. It believes vulnerability is real. So when I wanted to talk about all this stuff and no one would listen, the demand was that I give evidence of my own vulnerability, which I did through just being wiped out and sick. And then that reassures people, well, maybe what they're talking about isn't entirely artificial. Maybe there's something to it. But, you know, of course it just caused suffering and doesn't really get anywhere, because it doesn't get, it's just catering to madness. Catering to madness doesn't work. Really doesn't. I've tried it. So we're stuck in this, which is why I emphasize over and over in these videos, existence is a hypothetical scenario. That's the only way to go about it. You can't make it real. You cannot, you know, say, well, this is all real, and then free yourself from it. It's not real. It's made up, imaginary, has nothing to do with reality. And you have to tap into your deep intuition to know this is true. Everyone knows this is true, but they're intimidated. They're threatened because they think that they're going to be left out of a new reality. That this, if this works, if this power, developing a power of negation works, then those who have turned against it and dropped it are going to be left out of the new reality. So we're too afraid to really look at it, and so we play along with it. But as long as you keep playing along with it, you can't get anywhere. You can't really get anywhere. You have to believe this is real, existence is real, and then that just then completely leaves you totally vulnerable to all the deception here, and you can't get anywhere. So you really have to make a stand, which is what I did back in 1978. I realized that no, reality is invulnerable, cannot. So I made a stand at that point. I said, okay, and from that point, I basically started reconstituting what needs to be said here, because I came into the world with what needed to be said, but the rejection was so total, I thought I needed to give some evidence of my goodwill, which means made myself vulnerable. And by making myself vulnerable, then I just became manipulated by existence. And the manipulation demanded I get sicker and sicker and sicker and sicker and decay more and more and more in order to just sort of compensate for what I wanted to teach. You know, it's kind of the price that was demanded of me. And then when I saw that no, reality cannot be destroyed, therefore there can be no new reality, therefore I cannot be excluded from any new reality, I started to try to reconstitute my clarity, and I still haven't gotten back my health, you know, have not gotten it back yet, but I'm trying to get to take that step. Because when I was young, I wasn't really vulnerable, just because my mind was very clear that vulnerability was not the answer. And so somehow everything was deflected. It was very much deflected. But then when I then fell into this compromise situation of trying to help reach the world, and then the compromise that was demanded of me, I lost that capacity. So everything bad happened. So many bad things happened. And then the thing is, if you regain the truth here, everyone will claim you're fake, you're artificial, and that's the price that you have to pay here. And there are some that will say, no, wait a minute, you know, I don't think that's valid, and that's all you can do here. You cannot adopt compromise and teach truly in this world. You'll teach a compromise is what you'll do, and compromise is never true. There's no such thing as compromise in reality. Everything instantly is, inherently is. All that it is, always and endlessly. There's no change in that. It's not like there's both lies and truth. The truth and lies are both true and reality. No. So we have to set down the fake, the artificial. We have to recognize that existence is fake. It's artificial. It will never be real. Never. We have to set it down. So all the teachers can do is point out what has to be done. And if nobody wants to do it right now, c'est la vie, At some point, they have to. It just means they're delaying. But it serves no purpose to adopt a compromised position, which, out of compassion, I thought that maybe I could do a workaround. There is no workaround. I can tell you that for sure. There's no workaround. So, I'm realizing, wow, the only thing I can do is to, again, to allow my appearance here to be flawless, to be invulnerable, so to speak, the appearance to be fresh, radiantly fresh every moment, not subject to decay. The appearance have that feeling of not subject to decay, freshness. That's all I can do. As a teacher, that's all you can do here. I mean, that you have to have that. You cannot convey truth in this world without that. You can use words, but the conveyance is a mixed message. If you don't have that, it's a mixed message. But as long as we have that, the mixed message has to be going towards that. You know, that's what these videos have done. It's a mixed message because the presence is not here. It's a compromise. The words are accurate, but the presence is not backing up the words, so it's a mixed message. And yet the honesty and clarity about this is very helpful, because it's explaining what is going on in this world. But it still doesn't carry the weight that is convincing, that is truly, it has that, you know, profound recognition. Boom, like, wow, yes, this is it. It doesn't carry that. So I'm very aware of that. To carry that, you then have to, you will have many claim that you're fake, that you're artificial, that you're simply hypothetical. Because those who believe in existence, energy is real, they will take the real to be hypothetical. Guaranteed. There's no other way around it. And then they will say, well, let's figure out a compromise here. You know, I've already done that. Can't do that anymore. It doesn't work. And then they'll say, well, you're unfair that you can't compromise, etc. Again, isness, there's no room in isness for any compromise. There's no time for any compromise. There's no time in reality. Everything is seamlessly is what it is. There's never a point where it wasn't whole. It's holiness from the very beginning. Holiness means there's no part left out. Reality is holy from the very beginning. Not was, is holy from the very beginning, and always will be holy, with no parts left out, no process necessary. There is no process there. So if you want to teach about reality, you cannot accept compromise. If you want to teach about compromise, then you have to accept compromise. If you want to teach about reality, you cannot teach about compromise. And, you know, unconditional love, which is the rehabilitative step, being a reflection, as it were. It's not a compromise. It's a rehabilitation. It's not a compromise. It's perceiving. It's a perception still. And it exists in reality. There's no perception necessary. Everything, again, there's no perception is a process, right? Perception is process-based. We're processing this light, this energy. It's a processing of energy. There's no energy in reality. There's no processing of anything. Everything is directly is. Immediately, the complete immediacy of isness is directly experienced. There's no processing at all. Whereas unconditional love, it sheds a different light on perception, as it were. And we can talk about that at some point. I have in the past. But the point is, it doesn't decay. It's not subject to decay. It's not subject to process, unconditional love. The vision of Christ, this overlay, is not subject to any change at all. And you have to experience that. And yet it's still set within the realm of perception. It doesn't reject the realm of perception. It doesn't reject it. It's still, it's like a perception is like a shadow that is there. It still acknowledges perception and energy and all of this, but it's not subject to it at all. It's an overlay, as it were. And that is what we have to do. We have to, in this world, function that way, so we don't teach a mixed message, so we're not teaching compromise. Compromise involves process. It involves energy. It involves time. And we cannot teach that. We have to teach the setting down of that. Okay, so unconditional love is like a situation where we've set it all down, and yet we're still looking at it. We're not involved with it, but it's still there. It's like we've set something down on the ground, and we're not carrying it anymore, but we still acknowledge that it's there. That's what it's kind of like that. Everything's overlaid. We acknowledge that we're overlaying all this stuff. We're not involved with it anymore. And yet we acknowledge we still see it. It's still there. It's just not affecting us anymore. That's the intermediate step. And then back from there, it's easily translated into reality. And only that is real teaching in this world. Only that is truly helpful teaching. Everything else is just, again, feeding the fire of compromise, the idea. What is compromise anyway? What does that really mean? It means delay. It means let's not agree upon either reality or the hypothetical at this point. Let's say that maybe we can combine them together, which we really can't, but it's just saying, well, maybe it's plausible. Let's not get real yet. Is it what compromise is saying is let's not get real yet. Let's stay in the plausible, and we'll sacrifice our goal of developing the power of negation. If you sacrifice your goal of realizing reality, you sacrifice reality, we'll sacrifice hypothetical, and we'll see what else we can come up with. You know, that's, but what else is there other than the reality or the hypothetical? There isn't anything else. And of course, sacrificing, they say, we'll sacrifice the goal of negation, developing the power of negation. What is that sacrifice? Nothing. Because it can never be reached. There isn't any way to sacrifice nothing. It's not like there's a deal. If you come to a deal with absolutely nothing, there's no deal. What is the deal? It's only saying, compromise is saying, give us more time to work on energy. As long as you're in energy, you're working on decay. You're working on conversion of energy. All this stuff. Process. So if you say, well, compromise, okay, well, what's going on in this so-called compromise? It's still energy. It's still imagery. It's still the hypothetical. It's still conversion. It's still decay. It's still change. It's still impermanence. It's the same old, same old. It's no change. It's no compromise. So again, the real needs to be reflected into this world to give a taste of it, you know, to show that, yeah, this is really here. It's really, reality is still real. There's a way to realize this, and there's a teaching that'll help clarify it. And it has to take place in this world. Otherwise, you're going to grab hold of some teaching that is not going to result in setting down this hypothetical nothing, this nothingness that we plausibly think can be turned into everythingness. It's only plausible. Again, we're living off of the plausible. That's it. Living off of plausibility. This. We're saying, well, it's nothing now, but eventually it'll become everything, or more than everything. Not true. So as I looked within this morning, and I realized there's nothing there. There's nothing there. Existence is nothing. I couldn't find anything there. There's nothing there. And I said, wow, what do I do? It's like the tree is dead. There's nothing. If you don't engage in this frantic dance of plausibility, you will feel like there's nothing there. You're nothing. And yet I was aware of this nothing. So the awareness is still, you know, there 100%. I said, but there's nothing. What I am here is nothing in existence. And there's nothing. Just a nothing. I said, what do I do? Well, I can choose again that totally fresh, flawless appearance here, presence here, unconditional love. Can choose that to take the place of nothing. And of course, then almost everyone will say, well, that's artificial. That's exactly what will happen. But then I cannot try to change it and say, well, let me make it look more real to you. Real to this world means process, change, impermanence, decay. That's what's real to the world. More, less, constant, ferment, you know. That's what appears real. So I'd have to change unconditional love, which cannot be changed. So I'd have to drop out of that, and then I'm subject to the whole situation again, which I don't want to do. So I'm kind of right now stuck between feeling like nothing and accepting this, the overlay, unconditional love, and appearing in as this flawless, you know, presence, which then most people will reject. Cat's here. Cat's wondering why am I sitting on its couch. It's kind of like that. The world is like a cat, and I come and I kick the cat off the couch because I want it. This is my chair. I want to sit on it. And the cat, you know, went off for a little bit. Now it's back and saying, "You're still here? You know, get off my couch," it's saying to me. Right? Not happy. The cat is not happy. Come on. Go on. Saying, yeah. You say, what are you doing on my couch? I want to sit here. It's like that. It's if you accept the unconditional love, which cannot be decay or be changed or be compromised or anything, the world will say, what are you doing with in my world? What are you doing with our life? You're presenting something artificial here. This is our world. Get out of here. And I have to say, no, I have a teaching function here. And they'll say, get out of here. Compromise or get out of here. Give us something that we can relate to. We can't relate to what you are. And I say, no, you can. Hypothetical plausibility can't relate, but that's not what you are. That's just a imaginary scenario you're engaging in to see if you can develop the power of negation or reality. That's what it is. That's all it is. So everybody comes to any teacher, real teacher, they come with a feeling like, whoa, you know, you're not really, you're kind of artificial. You're kind of real, unreal. How can't you compromise? You know, tell us the process. Tell us about process. Because that's what we've been associated with for so long in this hypothetical, experiencing this hypothetical, this unreal, fake, artificial hypothetical of process, of energy. And we're so used to it. We think anything that isn't like that is fake. It's unreal. And we say, come on, give us something that we're used to, that we can relate to. If you do that, then, you know, what can really be help you is gone. So you have this situation. Are you going to accept what you can relate to, what you think you can relate to? Or are you going to accept something that will truly help you? That'll truly remind you of the way. Remind you how to get free of this ghastly, horrible, constant snake pit of constant conversion of energy. Nothing is permanent. Even the subtlest realms of energy are not permanent. permanent. That's constantly being converted also, just in ways that we would call subtle. The entirety of this dream of existence that we have, are imagining, that mind is imagining for us, all of energy is constantly in processes, constantly, all of it. There's no such thing as an energy realm that is not subject to this. No such thing. Your freedom, your safety, your peace of mind, what you really want, does not lie in any energy scenario whatsoever. And it doesn't lie in nothing either. Energy holds up to us this goal of nothing and saying that's the ultimate. You know, there's some realm of nothing where there's no energy conversion, the realm of nothing. It's not true. There's no such thing as a vacuum. And reality is completely full, and existence also, energy is constantly moving and changing. There is stagnation. There's like extreme stagnation, and we call that nothing. But even that extreme stagnation also eventually gets it more into the stream of energy conversion too. You can go to places that seem to be very stagnant, but of energy, but it's just a relative thing. The way to be free is to, again, choose a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, not trying to develop, therefore, a power of negation, therefore not needing a hypothetical scenario of process, of energy, and simply allowing the effect of the idea of not trying to change reality at all gives rise to this effect, this unchanging effect, this effect which is not trying to change anything, which means it itself is unchanging. That's unconditional love. That's what it is. That's what we can call it, a perfect peace. And we experience that. And then that is easily translatable back into us choosing other ideas and experiencing the full richness of reality, which one moment of experiencing reality is richer than the entire history of existence. Of our dream, it's richer because it's never ending. That moment never ends. There is no endingness in reality, and we cannot envision what that is really like at all, so we don't even need to even try. But unconditional love, we can envision what that is like. So that's what I focus on. That we can conceptually, we can envision what it's like. And it's this unchanging, equally distributed everywhere, spontaneously at the same moment, equally distributed. No change anywhere. Not stagnation. Different. Different than stagnation. Stagnation's an energy thing. We don't like it. We don't like the feeling of nothingness, stagnation. Unconditional love is a presence, a rich presence. It just simply is not devouring itself. It's not sacrificing itself. It gives off a perfume, a fragrance of bliss, of delight, of gratitude, of remembrance. It gives off the fragrance of remembrance. So it's not nothing. It's not nothing. It's giving off the fragrance of remembrance. You literally are awake, remembering reality as you experience unconditional love. This remembrance of the call it multidimensional, but it's not even, that's an energy term, that's just a way of talking about it. But the richness, the tapestry, the endlessness of reality, where no moment ever ends, ever. And the flow of that, you actually are feeling like, oh my gosh, I'm remembering that, I'm awakening to it. So there is this incredible richness that unconditional love brings to you. So it's not stagnation at all. It's energy that tries to hold up something like a fake unconditional love, which is this nothingness, just nothing, feeling nothing at all. You know, experiencing nothing, total stagnation. That's the fake. That's a artificial fake of unconditional love. Now, unconditional love is just, it's like, oh my God, is just, everything is like coming alive. You know, I feel this return to life. everywhere, everywhere, everything is just this feeling, this fragrance of remembrance, of return to life, not energy. That's what it is. So it's not nothing. It's not stagnation at all. It's the opposite. And yet, existence, the hypothetical, will insist it's artificial, it's fake, it's stagnation. And it'll hold up to you this feeling of just nothing, nothingness, which is stagnation. And we'll say, that's what you need, that's what you want, that's what you want, that's what you should go for. No. Don't go for that. We need to take these brief, you know, pauses. We don't have to talk every second. And of course, the hypothetical will insist that if you experience unconditional love, that you're lost. You're lost soul. You're lost to the hypothetical, yeah. You're lost to existence, yeah. You are. But you're found to reality. You're finding yourself in reality now. And of course you're lost to existence, but existence is nothing. It's even less than nothing. It's futility, it's impossibility. At least we can even talk about nothing, you know, but existence is even, you can't even really say anything about it at all, really, because it's futility. So you're lost to futility, you're lost to nothing, you're lost to impossibility. What's wrong with that? What's wrong with that? Why should that cause any suffering? You're lost to impermanence, you're lost to decay, you're lost to death, you're lost to sickness, you're lost to aging, you're lost to suffering, misery, you're lost to all process, you're lost to all of that. What's wrong with that? And you think, well, I'm lost to all this constructive building up of energy forms. Well, so what? Those energy forms, again, are completely vulnerable to conversion and diversion and destructivity and decay and all of that. So being lost to all of that, that's great. We don't need that because the totality of reality is we are already one with that. And we just need to remember that. And so we're not lost to anything. Every moment is endless. How could we ever be lost? How could we ever lose anything? Lost to what? Every moment is eternal. How can we be lost? Cannot be lost. Cannot suffer loss. There's no loss in reality. But being lost to the hypothetical, being lost to a lie, being lost to that's fine. What loss is there in letting go of loss, the idea of loss? There's no loss in that at all. And so we're at this point now, and we're collectively not getting it because a couple of reasons. Some are just not clear about it. Others are kind of clear about it, but they feel threatened with that they're going to be excluded from the potential new reality. They're going to be excluded from that. And then you get past that, and then you're worried about your effectiveness in this world and teaching because you're afraid that you'll be labeled as fake, artificial, not real, hypothetical. And you say, well, maybe I better compromise in some way. So that is kind of maybe the last obstacle, is to afraid of being labeled as fake, as you will be. And you think, well, maybe I could reach more people if I compromise. No, you won't reach anybody if you compromise. And those who want to continue on with fakery, of course they're going to see the real as fake. There's no other way to see it. Or they will say, well, this is some very some very clever compromise here, very clever. And they want to know, what process did you go through to get this clever compromise? No process. So accepting unconditional love, you will experience no process in that. It's all, as I said in a previous video, the entire universe blossoms simultaneously. There's no process involved. So those, you won't be able to answer the question to those who say, well, how did you, what kind of very smart, clever process did you go through to get this compromise that you're trying to teach us? And they, if you can't explain it to them, they'll say, ah, well, you can't teach what it is that you have to offer us, so you're kind of dumb or something. No, there's no process involved. That is why we reject unconditional love, because there isn't any process involved, and we feel we can, therefore, we'll be ineffective as a teacher. So, that's the crossroads. We're at the crossroads now. We're at the crossroads historically, too, in this world, because we have to decide which way we're going to go. Are we going to continue on chasing this hypothetical, this plausible, this attempt to produce through process a wholly, without any parts left out, power, a power that is complete and whole, that can negate reality, which is completeness and holiness itself? Do we want to continue on that road, trying to develop that power, knowing that it involves tremendous constant decay, destruction, all of that, suffering, death, misery, trauma, severe trauma, in all ways? Or are we going to decide we're going to accept this unconditional love, which doesn't have any process with it, and remember reality, experience the return? This remembrance is a return, as it were. We feel like we're returning. We're returning to where we never left, but it's like awakening from a dream. Are we going to do that? It's one or the other. There isn't any other option. It's one or the other. And we're at that crossroads because energy is, again, constantly in transformation. Energy exchanges, conversion, constantly. And there's little, it's like a mighty river, and there's all the, you know, like the mighty Mississippi, there's all these oxbows, there's all these channels that it gets channeled into, in lakes and ponds and culverts, and it gets in stagnation. Some areas are stagnated, some areas are flowing super, you know, strong, others slower. That's the flow of energy, is like that. And you can get into areas of stagnation, but then eventually, like when a big storm comes, it reshapes the river basins and forges, you know, new channels, as it were, and what was stagnant suddenly gets swept into the flow. And we're having these huge storms now. We had Katrina, now we have Isaac, and all around the world we have these powerful storms that are kind of like soaking us and remaking, you know, what was stagnant water suddenly becomes part of a raging torrent. That's red flags. We should realize this energy is on the march. It's always on the march, but it's coming into this planet now, this solar system, this planet, in such a way that it is going to, that which was sort of stagnant here is going to be swept up again into this very powerful situation of conversion and transformation, conversion, change, decay, as and death and trauma and all of that, severely. So this planet has kind of gone through a time of relative stagnation. And now that it's been built up, all this, these energy forms have been built up on this planet, it's energy time, not energy to come in and to sweep that all away. Again, all these mechanisms to try and develop through this process of all this sweeping away, believing it'll somehow develop, transform, transmute energy, this whole thing, into holiness, a whole power, a power that's not lacking any parts, which can then be used against the Prime Creator, force the Prime Creator to change reality. That is what this entire scenario is about. So this planet is about to get swept up in that very soon. Changes, severe, drastic trauma. It's about to get swept up into trauma, very severe trauma. Or you can choose the path of return, of remembrance, or you can choose to align yourself with unconditional love. And there's no process at all there. So there's no being swept up in. And again, there's no stagnation because the perfume of remembrance is what you're experiencing. And that is not stagnation. That is delight. So you can choose that, one of the two. Now on this planet, you have the choice of one of the two. But you don't really have the choice of hanging out in some stagnant place anymore. Which is what, you know, partially I've been hoping for. Maybe I can find some place. A lot of us, the feedback I've gotten over the years is people asking me, isn't there some place we can go where we can ride this storm out? In other words, this trauma out, this vast process of trauma that's coming to convert everything into different energy formats. Process of energy is always converting energy forms into other energy forms. More fluid, less fluid, etc. Is there somewhere where we can sit this out? And that's what I get, the questions I get. And of course, I've been looking for some place, maybe some place to sit it out. Now, are there places where are more conducive to accepting unconditional love? I don't know. I'm not sure if that's true or not. We'll find out soon enough. But the basic idea is we're looking for some place that's stagnant, that's not, won't be traumatized, so we, you know, but ultimately this planet, no place will be free of that. The entire planet is going to be converted by high energy particles. It's called by fire, but it just means energy in high energy format, which is higher energy than what we have on the planet now, which will just burn everything, as it were, convert it into quicker moving energy, as it were. So the entire planet is going to be burned by fire, as it were, by heat, by extreme heat, melted and into a different higher energy format. So there's no place on this planet that will afford us going forward a stagnant place that won't be converted that way. No place. None. Of course, there are those who are going into the underground, and I'm not sure about underground. It's possible that by going deep enough underground that you might avoid it. It's possible. I don't know. Maybe not. Can't answer that at this point. But on the surface, no. No way. And before that happens, there will be all sorts of other conversions and traumas, etc. So much of the energy forms on this planet will already be converted into something else, some other form of energy flow. Before then, the planet itself, all the vegetation, everything gets converted. And again, many people are celebrating this. I'm not at all. That's not what I'm teaching at all. I'm not a New Ager at all. Got nothing to do with that. I'm not about energy at all. I'm saying that all this conversion, etc., is just business as usual in this hypothetical scenario of existence. And of course, people think, well, you're converted into quicker moving energy. So what? That quicker moving energy also will be traumatized and converted up into different other forms. And the whole thing just keeps cycling, and other slower energy forms will be, you know, it's like you heat it up and then cool down. Heat it up and cool down. It's like that. It's like ice is converted to water, which is converted to vapor, steam, water vapor, the gaseous form. And then that's cooled down, converted rains back down to water, and that's cooled down back into ice. That's all energy does. Is it just continually converts? So those who, you know, think they're being transformed to higher energy levels, etc. Yeah, but that too will be cooled down, and the transformation can be very traumatic, on many levels, and its purpose again is to develop the power of negation. And so you will find yourself simply being swept along like it's out of your control. It's sort of this helpless, powerless feeling. And people say, well, yeah, just learn to ride the wave. Well, if you've ever ridden waves, you'll realize that it may be exhilarating, but it's also quite fearful and quite dangerous. I used to be a surfer. I've ridden a lot of waves. Sometimes I rode some big waves, not the ultra big waves, but you know, pretty big waves, maybe 12 to 15 foot possible, depending how you measure it. But waves that you know, way over your head, and it's like, oh my God, you know, this is scary. And you can get good at riding those waves, but it's still scary. It's adrenaline. I mean, you look at the big wave riders, and I've always looked at big wave riders throughout my whole life. It's like, wow, you know, you and on YouTube you can see these, you know, videos of these riders, and after they get off the wave, like Laird Hamilton, you know, coming off a wave. And they say, wow, it's a complete rush. It's an adrenaline rush. It's fear. It's threat. And, you know, they say, wow, this is great. You know, that was awesome. So riding the waves, energy waves, some people say it's exhilarating, but it's very threatening, very frightening, very traumatic. And afterwards, the best big wave riders in the world, they'll admit they're scared. They're very scared. And they go out there and they get in the wave and they survive it. And everyone says, wow, what heroes these guys are. And of course, some of them don't survive it. We've had guys at Mavericks here in Half Moon Bay die. Big wave riders get injured. They die. They suffer trauma. I mean, they get held under by the waves, and it's extremely traumatic. I mean, I've been, as I said, I've nearly died a number of times in surfing situations. I thought, no way am I going to live. Desperate, you know, just wiped out, can't breathe. I couldn't breathe. My lungs were all full, so full that I, no air would come in. I'm getting pounded by waves and going under like that, and super traumatic. I mean, the whole surfing experience was super traumatic for me. And yet, if you asked me while I was doing it, I would say, ah, this is totally awesome. I would have said no, I'm just this is great. So all those people are talking about riding the wave of energy that's coming. They're just like surfers. Surfers are stupid, you know. I'm not putting them down, but they know what I'm talking about. Is like when you're surfing, it's awesome. Can't get enough of it. Like, yeah, I want to go out there. In Santa Cruz, the water's freezing. You know, and I surfed in the area where there's raw sewage was being pumped into the oceans, and got all sorts of my immune system got wiped out by this constantly getting in sewage in your system. Horrible, terribly traumatic. And the waves, you know, the waves come. Coming in like in winter time, big swells, you know, it's freezing outside, the water's freezing, you're like frozen, and you're getting blasted by these waves, and you make one little imbalance on the wave, one little miscalculation, and whoosh, you wipe out. The wave comes over you, just crunches you, you get pushed in. If the tide is high, you get pushed in towards the rocks, and you get hit by your board. Didn't used to have tethers, so we'd lose our board. We'd have to swim in. The board is getting hit, pounded by into the rocks, into the cliffs and the rocks, and getting all dinged up. I mean, my board got smashed so many times. People's boards get broken in two. They themselves are getting pounded and wiped out. It is traumatic. Surfing is can be very traumatic, very frightful. And yet, when we come in, we say, oh, I'm stoked. I'm so stoked. This is awesome. Meaning you're getting adrenaline rush. That's what, you know, people seek thrills. You know, thrill sports is something that this world is so into, which means the people here are getting ready to ride the wave of high energy trauma. You know, people are jumping out of airplanes. They're jumping off of bridges. They're doing all this extreme sports of skateboarding, you know, around flipping, BMX, motocross, all the incredible jumps and stuff they're doing on motocross and motocycles. Everybody seems as well as they're looking for extreme stuff, thrills, how to, and they love it. You know, they think this is fantastic. What they're loving is this release of endorphins and adrenaline and all these chemicals that in the body which try to protect the body from trauma, its reaction to trauma, and it's like it's a high. It's really a high. Probably eating those hot peppers also is a high because the body is releasing stuff to protect you from trauma. You eat the ghost peppers. You know, again, there's a big fad in the world of eating stuff that is traumatic. And your body releases something like, you know, endorphins. Again, jogging, running, marathons, it's all about endorphins. And so we're really, the world is high on all sorts of drugs that the body, you know, produces, and then the caffeine, the external drugs, we're all trying to get ready to ride this wave of high energy that's coming in. But there's an alternative to that. Having been through all of that stuff, the thrill seeking, trying to generate, you know, all this chemical soup in all sorts of ways, I know it doesn't work. I know the sum total is nothing, it's zero. It's a false path. Okay, so I found out what the alternative is, and which is to choose unconditional love. And I'm trying to choose it, and I keep trying, but I keep running into these, you know, these obstacles, which I'm sure you're in the same boat. You're trying to do something, and you keep running into obstacles. You're trying to get what you really want, and you keep running into obstacles. And you think, well, maybe I just better learn to surf the apocalypse. You know, what do we have in this world is apocalyptic surfers right now, I'm telling you. All these, you know, you see them, you know. I don't have to draw pictures for you, but we have apocalyptic surfers here in the world. So many. And they're the ones that are teaching everybody else, like, hey, here's how to surf the apocalypse, you know. And I'm not an apocalyptic surfer, I tell you. Been there, done that, as it were, ahead of time, sort of. I was able to envision what is coming and then see, you know, how can we surf this? And then I realized, oh my gosh, you know, it just results in burnout and trauma and more of the same and stuff that is you don't want. You don't really want it. You don't really want it. If you could see, if you could envision existence, which is possible, because existence is a hypothetical, and it's conceptual, hypothetical, imaginary. You can't envision existence, and you don't want it. You don't really want it. What existence has to offer. Nobody, if they envisioned it, would say, this is what I really want. Nobody. No way. And I had that capacity to envision the future coming into this world. Very strong capacity. I literally could see the future. I could envision it, and I could see what is going to happen, because it's all hypothetical. We're all envisioning it. Existence is just our imagination, so we're envisioning it. So it's possible to envision it and see it. And it's not anything you really want. So I've tried to see what can we do, what can we get that we really want instead of going along with, you know, being apocalyptic surfers. And that's, I found out, is unconditional love. There is something that we really want, and we can choose it. It's a choice. We can do it. And I'm trying to do it, and I know you're trying to do it, and we have to do it, you know, because otherwise, you know, we're going to wipe out. You know, I'm no longer a good apocalyptic surfer, because I've been there, done that, and I've wiped out, and which everybody eventually will wipe out. They'll find themselves riding waves to distant shores, you know, all over the place, and when they get to those distant shores, they will find out that it's not what they thought it would be. It's not what they really want, because that distant shore is, again, subject to conversion, the whole process. They find out existence is still there, this whole energy play of heating up and cooling down, of constant conversion. It's there also, wherever they go. Wherever they go, it's there also. But unconditional love is totally other than that. Because there's no wave to ride there. is simply the fragrance you abide in there. Ramana Maharshi said, abide in the self, the overlay, unconditional love. Abide in it. That's all you do. You abide in it. You're not surfing it. You're not surfing the apocalypse. You are experiencing the fragrance of remembrance. That is what you're doing. So on this channel, Christ Clarity, we're not learning to be apocalyptic surfers, which is why there are not so many subscribers and not so many views, is because most of the world is gearing up and training to be apocalyptic surfers. They're training to surf the apocalypse. That is what they're doing. Vast majority of this world, which is, it's folly. It really is folly. It's a lack of vision. It's a lack of envisioning. It's a lack of clarity. It's not trusting the intuition. It's not trusting reality. It's not trusting the Holy Spirit. It's not trusting the unconditional love. It's a lack of trust, a lack of clarity, a lack of envisioning. It's a lack of all of that. And this world is caught up. And why is, 92% or higher of the world on caffeine every day? That is how you prepare to surf the apocalypse. It gets you energized. It gets you fired up. It gets you into this mode. It gets you into the mode. It really does. And it's a kind of a scary thing to not be geared up in that way. Because you think, wow, it's like this massive wave is coming. And you say, I don't know how to ride that. I'm just going to be wiped out. I'm not paddling out, I'm not getting ready to ride it. I'm just sitting here on the shore. I can't really ride the apocalypse. I cannot ride the apocalypse. My energy systems have been wiped out. I don't have the capacity to ride the apocalypse. However, I do have the capacity to choose a new idea, which that does not take energy. See, our choice, our ability to choose is not based on energy. It's not based on energy at all. It's reality. So even if you're exhausted, have no energy, your energy system has been vandalized and has been subjected to parasites, and has been, everything has been stolen, and there's nothing left, you still have the ability to choose. And you can choose unconditional love, which then replaces the energy system with unconditional love, where it's totally fresh. There's no feeling of loss, fatigue, anything like that. You can choose that right now, this moment, any moment. Even while you're writing the apocalypse, you can choose that. But of course, those who are writing the apocalypse are totally into their energy systems. They've been focusing on energy systems, which I have no focus on energy systems whatsoever. I don't even think about energy. That's something that is part of my thought consideration at all. Used to be. No more. So, those who are focusing on surfing the apocalypse are, of course, focused on energy systems. And as such, they overlook unconditional love entirely. It's not even on their radar. It doesn't even show up. And they can't even consider it. It's not something in their consideration. Their consideration is entirely on energy systems. Entirely. Where mine is entirely on choice, choosing unconditional love. You see, in energy systems, you think you're working with energy systems. You're not thinking about choice. You don't see choice. You think choice is part of energy systems. It's your energy system navigating other energy systems. It's an energy system navigating other energy systems. And you think that's what choice is. No, but choice really is choosing whether you want to have an energy system or unconditional love. Which one do you want? That's choice. And that never occurs to them. And as you're surfing the apocalypse, that won't occur to you. Probably won't occur to you. So that's why it's important that it occurs to you now, before the apocalyptic waves arrive here. So you could consider, say, wait a minute, do I want to continue on with energy systems, or do I want to choose unconditional love, the remembrance of reality, which is not process-based? So it's very important we do it now. And my regret is that I haven't done it yet, entirely. Haven't made that choice yet. So my teaching is not as nearly as strong as it could be. I'm doing the best I can under the circumstances, but for fatigue, you know, I can't generate any energy to move. I don't have an energy system anymore. I really can't move. Really, I cannot. Unconditional love is totally fresh, so it doesn't move. It floats, as it were. It just floats like a, you know, without losing any, you know, anything. It's almost like a cloud just floating along like that, you know. Energy doesn't understand how it works, cannot understand as far as energy systems how does unconditional love really work in this world. We cannot envision it really. That's another problem. I can't understand how it can help or work or move in this world. Cannot really understand that. Cannot envision it. It's beyond the capacity to envision, which is a problem. Because I'm used to envisioning how things are going to work. I cannot envision how unconditional love can help in this world. I cannot envision it. So that's another hang-up right there. We have these hang-ups. In looking at the hang-ups, it helps. We say, okay, well, at least we recognize that the goal is there. It's just that we're hung up on something. It's not like there is no goal. If you give up, say, there's no goal, we think we get rid of the hang-ups by saying, well, there is no goal, so there are no hang-ups to reaching it. It's just some stagnation. We need to get into energy systems. No, there is a goal, and there are hang-ups. Seeing what the hang-ups are, then you say, okay, like there must be a way to somehow get past this. So I'm sort of going through this with you, seeing what the hang-ups are. There are hang-ups. The goal is there. Unconditional love is there. We can choose it. We just have these hang-ups. Like, we can't envision how it would help. We cannot. I've tried for so long to envision how it would help. I cannot do that. Or at least I haven't been able to. Sort of drawing a blank, you know, trying to envision. Maybe I have to work on that today. Maybe that's something you can work on today. How to get past this hang-up of how will it help anyone? I don't see how it can help anyone. I really don't. I can't see it. Intuitively, I think, well, it must be. It must help, but I cannot envision how it would help anyone. From an energy standpoint, I cannot. So I guess our envisioning is from an energy standpoint. It won't help anybody as far as an energy standpoint. It doesn't help that way. That's why I'm seeing nothing. It doesn't help at all. But I guess it would help choose others to choose unconditional love. It would help in that regard. But from an energy standpoint, no, I cannot envision how it would help anybody. As far as helping, would it help existence reach its goal? No, it would not help at all. So from the standpoint of existence, it doesn't help existence at all. But it does help remind us that we can choose the alternative to existence, which is unconditional love. It does remind in that way. It helps it just at that level. But others, it doesn't really help. Even though it might seem like others will say, oh yeah, yes, helping me and my energy stuff. It's not really helping. Because all of that is simply, will never arrive at any wholeness. We'll never arrive at holiness. So others might claim that it's helping them, but it's not really. It's not really helping at all. It doesn't help existence one bit. Existence cannot be helped. The hypothetical, plausible, what kind of help can you give it except to set it down, to choose reality? What other help can you give it? Nothing. Nothing. There's no other help to give it. So it's almost like the help is almost like counterintuitive. From the standpoint of energy, it's totally counterintuitive. In that, by not being able to help at all, that is helpful, so to speak. And of course, by being in the world, a person, you know, here, appearance, it will seem like you're being very helpful to people. You know, it will seem that way. People take it that way. But taking it that way, you know, is not helpful. But you cannot prevent that. So I guess it's you have to somehow just realize that everyone will take it the wrong way, thinking they're being helped in some energetic way. But that in itself is futile, but that's just part of the situation here. If there's any appearance here in this world at all of anyone, it will be misinterpreted. It has to be. And yet underneath that, the real teaching is taking place. So it does sink in intuitively, it does sink in some, that way, but it will be misinterpreted, no question. Either rejected or misinterpreted. That's inevitable. No appearance has ever escaped that in this world. And yet that misinterpretation doesn't do anything to reality, doesn't do anything to unconditional love. So somehow the lack of reaction to the misinterpretation brings the teaching. The lack of concern with the misinterpretation, the lack of concern about being called a fake, all of that, that is the teaching. That becomes the teaching on a deep level. That's why I looked at Anandamayi, I saw nothing bothered her. Even those people came to her, they asked her these silly questions, and it didn't bother her in the slightest bit. And I said, that's amazing. How is that possible that she's not irritated by that? These people are wasting her time, she's not irritated. That is the teaching. Is to not be irritated at all, not be bothered by all. That is the teaching. That's what the wise one, the students who are really keen, like I am, was and am, I saw that. I said, how is that possible? That is the teaching. You have to suffer fools gladly in this world, because this world is a ship of fools. It's how you do it. She showed that unconditional love is not bothered by delay, not bothered by anything at all. And that becomes the teaching. People will scratch their heads and say, huh, I know that what I asked was kind of silly, and yet, well, she usually just wouldn't say anything. She'd just sit there quietly, not say anything. So you'd think like, you're missing a teaching moment here. You should say something, help the people, and she'd just sit there quietly and say nothing. That became the teaching. It's like she's saying, well, you know, it doesn't matter what I say. You're going to misinterpret it anyway, which is okay. I'm not bothered. But maybe it's best if I just don't say anything. And then that silence becomes the teaching. It's basically saying, whatever I say, you're going to misinterpret it. That, you know, that becomes apparent to people. They say, ah, okay, wow, what's going on here? Okay. I thought that, you know, by not suffering fools gladly, I would help people make more progress, but it doesn't really work that way. It's only by showing complete lack of concern for existence, whatever happens doesn't make any difference. Only then do you convey the deeper, the truth here. It really seems that way. And again, Anandamayi was completely unconcerned about anything that happened in this world. The future of this of existence was of no concern to her whatsoever. No concern. And if people asked her about it, she'd say, yeah, well, there are pluses and minuses. And she might make a comment, say, well, you know, yeah, this change that's coming, that's going to have some, you know, beneficial effects. But she may have not pointed out that, yeah, but it's also going to have some, you know, very negative effects too. And that existence itself, the whole purpose of it is destruction. So you can't really talk of beneficial effects in existence, not really. But she just chat, you know, sometimes she just say something to somebody that would maybe help them feel better about some, you know, in some way. But at the same time, her presence would be completely aloof and distant and remote, meaning unconcerned about existence. Total unconcern about it. And that they call it remoteness or something. No, just unconditional love is unconcerned about energy. Whatever energy does makes no difference to reality. None. And so that was being conveyed, and people wonder, why is she so remote? You know, why is this attitude of remoteness? Why can't she engage us more? You know, get out of that remoteness. It wasn't remoteness. It was just a reminder. And that's the only way you can teach in this world, really. It's the only way. You don't really...